I've been hearing more and more people say lately that there aren't enough hours in a day. I wonder why this is. Are we doing things we would rather not be doing with our time? Are we feeling pressure from a job we don't like? I feel like time is one of the most precious gifts we've been given, yet many times we throw it away. I've been to Guatemala 7 times with the Dottenberg family, and ever since meeting them, it's been a dream of mine to share their story. Every single visit, I witness people who spend their time hungry, thirsty, and desperate. They wouldn't even be able to comprehend the rat race. There is so much emptiness that lies in the quest for more. Perhaps it is us who needs to be willing to change. Change how we live, change how we think, change how we use what little time we have. Because in the end, it's not what's in your pocket that matters. It's what's in your heart.
It started all the way back, even when I started the roofing company, just wanting to work with people who seemed maybe lost or seemed confused or, just maybe not even getting everything they wanted out of life. You know, sometimes ex-convicts, sometimes teens that needed somebody in their lives that was maybe a little different than what they would typically hang around with in their social circles.
I remember really early on him and I talking about how we were going to be millionaires by the time we were 35. And we were going to retire, and we were going to travel, and we were going to do all kinds of things, and we were just going to make a ton of money and have nice cars and a big home, and that was kind of our way of following the American dream, so to speak. We went for 2 weeks to Dominican Republic, to an all-inclusive resort, and we were going to relax and chill, and ended up being a very bad rainstorm that lasted almost the entire 2 weeks we were on the island. And him and I rented a Jeep and decided we were gonna go out and try and help the Red Cross. We were bored. We were bored sitting around. We were bored drinking froofy umbrella drinks. We were just bored. We took off in a Jeep and we were trying to help people pull their little huts out of the raging ditches. And then we got kicked out from the Red Cross. They wouldn't let us help because we were just people and they didn't have insurance and stuff. So we ended up trying to book a flight home early because we were just bored of the relaxing and the sitting on the beach. If I think back, I think that was a time when him and I both realized that we just weren't made for maybe the American dream. But through the years, we continued to pursue it. We had beautiful Roush Mustang, we had a Ford Edge, we had an old house, but it was nice for us, and we just had all the things we could possibly want in our lives, and yet something was still really missing.
Geoff and Rita have 3 boys, Zach being the oldest, followed by Luke and Gabe. Following their hearts, they began their journey years ago by helping in the rebuilding of Gulfport, Mississippi, and New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. A few years later, they found themselves in Alaska with Habitat for Humanity, as well as many other outreach programs in the Niagara region. Nothing seemed to fit until they were invited to Guatemala in 2010 to chaperone a youth missions trip. Geoff grew up in an agricultural family and has extensive knowledge in construction and contracting. They owned a big roofing company in Canada for 15 years. Rita has studied holistic nutrition and has a background in finance. Over the last few years, they went from 90-day trips, working towards 6-month trips. They eventually sold their house and put all of their belongings onto a sea container to be shipped to Guatemala. Currently, the Dottenberg family hosts volunteers of all ages and all skill sets, and to date, they have hosted over 250 people.
a lot of what we do and what we recognize from the beginning is that first and foremost, relationship is so hugely important here. We've started a project in, it's a village called El Salitrillo. What we learned was just giving things, whether it be giving one individual a small house that they need, giving a few families smokeless stoves, running medical clinics, helping with the schools, building schools. All those things are great, but you kind of have to figure out how you can tie it all in together, what the greatest need is, but also what is sustainable. We have basically initiated a program where each family gets a solar light, a water filter, and nutritious plants and trees, including moringa, chaya, chia, amaranth, neem, which is an insecticide, again, fighting malaria, and dengue, and so on. This program, in essence, is very sustainable, is really, at this point, the greatest solution that we could come up with. So we basically go into one village at a time, do the entire village so there's no favoritism, there's no jealousy, there's no envy. Everybody's treated the same. Everybody has the same opportunity where they can be part of the program, which includes, like I say, the filter, the solar light, and the plants.
Pues yo les agradezco porque ustedes vinieron y trajeron pues este proyecto de paneles solares y filtros que nos sentimos muy contentos porque ciertamente ha habido un cambio, ¿verdad? Ciertamente ha habido un cambio porque lo que no habíamos visto pues hoy lo vemos, ¿verdad? Si ustedes vinieran por la noche se ve diferente las luces en las casas, ¿verdad? Ajá. Pues en lo que es ayuda de otros países no lo hemos recibido hasta el momento, únicamente solo la que ustedes pues han traído.
This is a 10,000 liter of water tank for the village of El Terrero. We're gonna install two. This is the first one. It was gonna be the most, well, the hardest one, you know, to put in place. We had a huge hole, as you're gonna see soon in this place. Look at these people, they work so hard. But let me help them too, okay?
Look ahead We got a bunch of stumps right here. I don't know if we're gonna be able to get around with these.
A big problem we've always heard from North Americans when they give to NGOs and governmental projects is there's no follow-up. They parachute in, they do a water project, or they build a school, or they give them filters, or whatever the case may be. They come in, they give it, they leave, they never go back, there's no follow-up. And if a year or two or 5 years later they do go back, they find out that it's completely failed because there was no, number one, no follow-up, but number two, no, call it maintenance of the program, which is a huge reason that we wanted to have the people themselves pay for a portion of it, because it gives them pride of ownership. If they're paying for it, they're respecting that this is costing them money, but this is hugely beneficial to their families. Obviously, we could raise the money to give everything, but if we have to go back to collect payments, we also can monitor what's happening. Are the filters being used properly? Are they having problems with them? Are the lights having any problems? The plants, the trees, we can monitor the growth, monitor the irrigation, monitor the use. The other great thing with it is a lot of the products are exportable, are products that are in high demand in developed countries where hopefully we can establish a connection with all of the people that they use part of this for feeding their families, making sure their children are healthy and fit, but also in the future be able to have a product that is in demand in the world market and be able to provide them an income that legitimately is fair trade and will make a huge difference for them as well.
A little girl that came to the hospital a couple months ago that, of course, I met like about a week after she arrived at the hospital, and we kind of really connected more than I have with a lot of children that I've previously met at the hospital. She was about 3 years old and the cutest little girl. Her name was Lucrecia. She was just energetic and she liked to play around with the other kids, and she was just the funniest little sweetheart. And at one point, we didn't go to the hospital for over 2 weeks, and we finally decided to go to the hospital. And when we got there, I started walking around, playing with the different kids, and I noticed that she wasn't there. And so I went up to one of the girls, and I'm like, "So, where's Lucrecia? Where is she? I want to see her. I want to play with her." And she's like, "About a few days ago, she passed away." Yeah, she, over those 2 weeks that we weren't there, she was gone. And she was so healthy, I don't know what happened. And I kind of lost hope for a little while. Then about a week passed and we went up to the village that we were helping, El Salatrio. And I got up there and I saw the kids and they were smiling and laughing and so happy. And there, just, it hit me that what we're doing is making a difference. We've been helping so many people, and it's really been making a difference. That village is just, the change we've seen in them has just been so amazing. At that moment, I just realized that this is where I want to be, and this is where I'm supposed to be.
Hemos gestionado muchas cosas al gobierno central de nuestro país, a las autoridades locales, las cuales pues no han escuchado nuestra petición, ya sea en proyectos de agua potable, estufas ahorradoras de leña, árboles frutales, luz solar. Y nosotros en la comunidad trabajamos para que el proyecto se lleve a cabo, ¿no? Ponemos, aquí nosotros le nombramos como la mano de obra, porque a veces cuando solo dan las cosas, cuando solo uno recibe, como que no se le pone mucho cuidado. Pero cuando a uno le cuesta algo, cuando uno suda para obtener lo que uno verdaderamente necesita o quiere, uno pues se siente, ¿no? Se siente el sabor, se siente qué alegría. $2,300
por ahí.
And how many do they need for a house? $3,700 to go.
En total se van a hacer 3,000.
3,000.
3,000, ajá.
3,000.
Three?
Thousand.
Okay.
3,000. Rita, you gonna try the bucket?
I'm gonna try the bucket.
This lady's done 500 today, barefoot. Rita's going to try one.
Oh my gosh.
Heavy?
It's pretty darn heavy, dude. I'll never get up here.
Lean forward.
Don't help.
Yeah.
I almost lost it there.
Only 700 to go.
That's heavy.
There you go. Mucho más.
Mucho.
We look at the way they live and we think, oh, we have to do this and we have to do that and we have to make it better and we have to improve it. But what we found over the course of the years was that we weren't actually improving anything. What we were doing was bringing North American problems into a place that they didn't exist before. If we built someone a house that we thought they needed, then we created jealousy in the village. You just really have to look at their lives and what they really, really need. And you have to listen. We had to do a lot of talking, a lot of learning, a lot of getting ourselves out of this mind frame that this isn't right. We're learning every day, and what's really helping us is to be here. We've done projects that have been great successes. We've done projects that have been failures. We've brought problems into villages where problems didn't exist before. We started a program here teaching the women to crochet in the villages. I was so excited about this program because I thought that we would teach them to crochet, they could sell their wares, they could make some money, they could maybe make a decent wage and move to Antigua and, you know, or get out and pay for things. And we did these big classes and we taught the women to crochet. And some were good at it, some were not. We created a jealousy inside the village where the women were infighting with each other, and we had to have meetings upon meetings upon meetings. And it was just something that, from the best of intentions, the goodness of our hearts, we wanted to work. We had one girl who far exceeded everyone else, and she did such amazing work. She didn't work from patterns, she just picked up needles and made these beautiful bags and these beautiful sweaters and things like that almost instantly. And the other women got so jealous, and it was just absolutely a disaster for me. And oh my gosh, I shed so many tears over that, thinking, what did I do? What have I done? I brought all this infighting.
We have guests all the time, and we were going sometimes weeks with no water. So finally we went to the mayor, who, again, even that, he's become a great friend of ours and has actually helped us with the water project in El Salitrillo with the chlorinating system. I went to see him about the water, and he said, you know what, you're right, we can't have that. You know what, there's a main line coming into the town of El Progreso. It's a 6-inch line. It goes to a reservoir where from then it branches off, and typically here it's on a rotation that each household, each sector gets 2 or 3 hours a day of water. And he said, you know what, the main line going to that, nobody's allowed to tie into, but for you guys, we're gonna let you guys tie into the main line because you need water. So he said, if you dig a trench, it's 1/4 of a kilometer away from your house. If you dig the trench, then I'll send the guys to do the tubes and install everything. So we were working actually on the water project in Salitrillo at the time. So we had mentioned to, again, our amazing friends there, I just said, you know what, I'm sorry guys, but we need to take 2 or 3 days off of working here because we need to work on our own water. So I'm sorry, but I'll be back in a few days because tomorrow morning I'm starting on ours. I didn't mention anything, I didn't ask for any help, I just said, this is what I have to do. So anyway, the next morning I got up, I did my usual early morning emails, and then as soon as it started to get light, which is about, I guess, 5:30 at that time it was, I went outside with my pickaxe to get started on digging the trench, which is no easy task here in Guatemala. And I opened the door, and there was 5 guys from the village of El Salitrillo sitting there. And I said, what are you guys doing? And they had their pickaxes and their tools, and they said, well, you know what? You told us that you had to work and you're doing everything for us, so if you have to dig a trench, then we're digging a trench with you. There's no way you're doing that on your own. They had left their homes at 3 o'clock in the morning to walk down to our house to help us. And that was, to me, one of the most amazing moments of my life, where it just hit me like, wow, you know what? We do have a great relationship. we're not just the gringos coming in that they can take things from or that we can give things to them. You know what? They're here with us together. So they actually dug the entire trench in one day, which was just incredible.
Lo importante que yo he visto en ellos, ¿verdad?, de que la labor de ellos es enfocarse a las personas más necesitadas, o sea, la gente pobre de las áreas, más que todo rurales, ¿verdad?, donde podemos también subrayar también las jornadas médicas que han traído, valorar que ellos pues dejaron su país, ¿verdad?, Canadá, para venir a radicar acá a Guatemala, especialmente en el municipio de Progreso, en donde yo creo que ahí pues demuestran ese espíritu humanitario que ellos tienen hacia las personas más necesitadas.
On our first visit to the hospital, the very first time we ever came to Guatemala, I met a little boy. And I asked her, Madame Mercedes, who is this boy? What's his name? And she said his name is Estuardo. And he was in a crib, and his body was curled up in the fetal position. So he was very small, mentally challenged, unable to move very much other than to squeeze my hand and the odd time give a smile and blink and just kind of stare at you. When she told me Estuardo was 17, I thought she misunderstood the question because he was so small and he had wasted away so badly that I actually couldn't believe he was the size of Lucas and Gabriel, really. It sounds really bad, but the people here have to make decisions sometimes. If you have a family of seven and five are strong, and two are weak, and we don't have enough food to feed the seven, then maybe we feed the five, and we'll feed the other two a little bit, enough to keep them alive, but maybe we don't even have that much. And Estuardo was one of those kids. So I used to sit with him and hold his hand, and it was really cool. He would squeeze my hand, and I just felt so overwhelmed by this boy. I don't know what it was about him that touched my heart. We couldn't have a conversation. He couldn't talk to me. All he could do was look at me and squeeze my hand, and the odd, maybe it wasn't a smile, maybe it was, I'm not sure. But he did spend time with me and me with him, and I just remember thinking, this is so unfair. This is not right. We left that year. And when we came back the following year, the first place we went was the hospital, and full of hope and everything, I run in and I say to Hermana Mercedes, Estuardo's gone, where is he? And she said, oh, he went home. And I was so happy. I was like, oh, thanks be to God, he went home. And she touched my arm and she said, no, he went home, meaning he had passed away. I don't know why, I just cried and cried and cried like I'm gonna cry now because I can't tell this story without crying ever. But this boy, he never spoke to me. People say, what did he contribute to the world? Why not help someone? There is no one that is insignificant. There is no one that is unimportant. And this boy affected my life more than anyone else here ever has, and was totally 100% responsible for my decision to come here and stay here and live here. And I wrote a blog about him, and I said, like, this boy is he's a star in my night sky, and this kid to me, he was a superstar. He did more for my life than most people ever have. And it was a matter of a couple of weeks of holding the hand of someone who couldn't even speak to me. And it's just really profound.
Thank you.
This is Maria Lisa. She's 2 months old. She was born here at the dump, which I can't even imagine giving birth here among the garbage and the pigs and the cows. I just think, like, having a baby among the garbage, if there's, like, I look at you, you had complications. I would find a little spot to bury you here at the dump.
Yeah, what do you do if your baby has some...
You just let them die and you bury them. Like, I don't understand why this is like this. And we have so much, and I sit at home and I complain that I have to sit in an emergency room for 6 hours, and that's inconvenient. These people just bury their kids with the pigs. As North Americans, we always strive for more. It's never going to be enough, ever. No matter what you think material-wise is going to make you happy, it's never going to do it. It's never going to satisfy that hole we have, because that hole is not to be filled with things. It is to be filled with love. I'm not saying you have to go to Guatemala, or you have to go to Africa, or you have to go anywhere. What I think, and this is just me, what I believe is you have to get off the couch. A few years ago at the Leadership Summit, I'll never forget, it's Geoff in my favorite speech I've ever heard from a pastor, ever. We spend so much time in the huddle, we never get out of the huddle. We huddle around and we talk about things and we raise awareness and stuff like that. And while awareness is great, if it ends at awareness, nothing will ever change. Noelia's cooking on the stove we put in. Uh-huh. Rice right now.
Sí. Mm-hmm.
All her kids, everybody had lots of phlegm, many, many illnesses from the chest, the back, which pain in the back for the lungs is really, really bad. And now nothing. The kids are not sick, everybody's healthy. So.
Yeah, there's no smoke.
No smoke. See, look at this. It's beautiful. Using the dirty water was making them sick. So now we've told them, make sure you use the clean water to do this because it's not heated at a high enough temperature to kill the bacteria and parasites.
Bueno, recuerdo porque mi hija es solo leña.
Wow, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
I like it, the precise OCD.
Oh dear. Oh, see, Mike. Oh, don't film this.
I got this.
They do it like this, and I.
Gabe.
See, look. Oh, don't put it beside mine.
Yeah.
Okay. I am. Hey.
Got this. Mira.
Mine's really good.
Ay, Dios. Mucho sal.
My tortilla blew up. I don't know what butter. I did wrong.
Your tortilla is turning into a bun.
I know. It's good. I made a pita.
Look at
not
you.
Not really a tortilla.
Nice.
Yeah.
You know what you have to do? Fill that with meat.
Bien pues.
Oh, go for another try.
Keeping in mind, she's probably made about 3 million of those.
See how hers comes off her hand. Mine's like...
Bien, bien. Yes.
So she's just saying she's so excited because Lisa is 9 years old and can make a tortilla now. This is a big thing here. When you make tortillas, you're a woman.
Yo antes padecía mucho de cosas en los pulmones, solo que el hervor de pecho. Ya hoy no, yo ya hoy me siento bien. No tengo nada en mis pulmones, porque ya con la plancha ya el humo sale, ya uno vive mejor. Han hecho un gran esfuerzo en agua para que estos niños, antes mucho vivían con vómitos, asientos, ya hoy no. Nadie, gobierno, nada, han hecho nada como ustedes. Y yo eso agradezco.
Another thing that we really hope that people will investigate and inquire about is not only what positive difference a program is making, but are there possibly detrimental effects? We as people from developed countries sometimes get stars in our eyes where we just think, wow, what a great deal, you know, what a difference this is going to make. But what we have to think about is how is it affecting the people's lives themselves? How is it affecting the environment? How is it affecting the local economy? For example, when we started, we would buy, they call them pacas, which is the clothing cubes. And we would buy 1,000 pounds of clothes and we would go and distribute them. What we didn't think about was there is so many stores locally that's their business. They buy these bundles of clothes, they open them, and they sell the clothes for very reasonable prices. So when we give away clothes, we're now taking business from the local businesses selling those same clothes.
This is a bale of clothes. It's 1,000 pounds of clothing that comes from all the different countries, new clothes. And they bale it like that into 1,000 pounds.
The other way, right?
And we sort it and take it up into the mountains and give it to the people. We put it right beside our 12,500 bags of water.
There's a lot of buy one, give one programs where you buy a product in a developed country and then that, it's social entrepreneurship, that company then gives the same product in a developing country. Well, what about the manufacturers of those products that exist in those countries? We've seen firsthand what happens when products are given. We've seen businesses have to close because all of a sudden things are being given.
Go for a sip, buddy.
Take a sip too.
Yep. I want some.
Here.
What's it taste like?
Water.
Water.
That's pretty much it. Water.
Crystal clear.
Guatemalan spring water.
Cleaned.
Nice.
It's good, eh?
I like it.
Yeah. And it's clean. No floaties.
No floaties.
Nope.
All right.
No bacteria, no parasites.
Cheers.
For me, why I wanted to come to Guatemala started in the village of El Salitrio, high up in the mountains. The first time we went up there, we saw that the kids and all the people were happy and just happy with what they have, even though they're hungry, don't have any food. For me, I knew from the first time I went up there that they would never admit that they needed help. But in my heart, I knew that they did. Over the years, we started going down longer. And when my parents asked if we wanted to move down there full time, we all never hesitated to say yes. But I think we especially were really nervous and scared. Our family has gotten way closer by moving there to Guatemala because my dad was always working, my mom was always, or used to work. But now we're all working as a family and doing all this as a family, and it's bringing us closer together.
The first time we went to Guatemala, I was 15. You know, I was still the kid that was going on basically a two-week vacation to Guatemala and then going back to high school and the norm of things. 5 years later, I now live there full-time. I'm fluent in Spanish. I met a girl who I am now married to. I have a son. So basically, life has changed for me in an extreme amount. And it has changed for the better. I absolutely love my life there. I love the beauty of the country, the joy of the people, the way they welcome you is literally, for me, it's heaven on earth.
Y nosotros también tenemos la confianza en ellos y los tratamos como una familia, ¿verdad? Una familia canadiense, por el agradecimiento de lo que tenemos ya hoy, el agua, gracias a Dios, tenemos ya por lo menos, ¿eso qué?
Agua pónica,
y que primero Dios todo lo salga bien, ¿verdad? Porque ellos, desde ese momento que conocieron la pobreza que había donde quieran de nosotros, pues ellos se han puesto con ese amor, con esa voluntad de trabajar con nosotros. Y como nosotros tampoco lo hemos dejado en ningún momento solos. Y siempre seguimos apoyándoles en todo proyecto que vengan. Estamos para apoyar en nuestra comunidad.
Our dream is that as soon as possible, we've worked ourselves out of a job, more out of a need for ourselves and people like us to be in developing countries. Our hope is that one day there will be no more suffering, there will be no more hunger, there will be no more kids dying of starvation. We will be caring for the planet, we will be caring for the people, but there won't be a need for malnutrition centers, orphanages, NGOs, governmental aid. We've seen amazing positive impact on the villages that we have started with. And when we first started, we thought it's impossible. It's never gonna happen. It's a daunting task that we would need 20 lifetimes or more to accomplish, but I don't think so. I have now extreme hope, and I believe that it can happen in our lifetime if we all just try.
Put that in your mouth right now, I'm gonna beat the bag out of you.
Oh, the salt. Hold on.
Good.
There's our dinner. Yeah.
corazón, mi amor.
Greatest joys here is to actually see the programs working. Our model village, we picked it because it had a high incidence of children entering into the malnutrition center here. In the last couple years since we started our program there, there's no more kids entering the malnutrition center. Out of a village of 130 people, we've watched health improve by 75%. Bacterial infections from dirty water go down by 92%. You know, that's not to pat ourselves on the back and say we have all the answers. We are constantly learning what works and what doesn't. But what we're doing is making a difference in people's lives. People are healthier. People are gaining access to clean water, food, education. By listening to people over the last 5 years, it's really actually changing lives. There's no feeling in the world like that.
Time. One of the most incredible gifts we've been given. Every second, a new opportunity. Sometimes the task ahead seems too big, so huge that we feel paralyzed. But we are all able to affect real change in this world. To help those who cannot help themselves, to use our time to extend a hand to those in need. A hand to help them stand on their own. It all might seem like drops in a bucket, but if people really use their time, eventually the bucket will be full and overflowing.